Welcome to technical session number 13. Remember, we do these out of order. You don't necessarily go one, two, three, four. Sometimes we jump around a little bit because we're trying to parallel all the material we're trying to deliver so that we can kind of keep things in pocket and everybody's kind of focusing on the same things at the same time. All right. So today we're going to be talking about display devices. We're going to be talking about different types of display devices and their respective characteristics, and to a degree, the evolution of display devices over time. We're also going to be talking about the purpose of projectors. Obviously, it is, you know, a much larger display device. We're going to describe the different settings of monitors and how to adapt them. Identify the video ports and connectors that are utilized to connect monitors. We saw that yesterday in our Jamboard session where we had the DVI connectors. We're going to be talking about some of those. We're going to be talking about VGAs a little bit more, HDMI cables, and kind of display ports, all that kind of fun stuff. All right. BSMs for this particular technical session are teamwork. IT is a team sport. Because remember what we said in the beginning? Anybody who tells you they know everything about IT is lying to you. And in any given team, you're going to have various skill sets. People are going to have different strengths than you. So some people may be better at networking. Some people may be better at telecom. Some people may be better at scripting. Some people may be better at security. And we need to properly utilize that team and lean on that knowledge and also learn from each other. That's the biggest thing because... trust me, if they know shortcuts and ways to do things, you're going to want to pick up those things because it's another tool in your toolbox. It makes you even more valuable to your team and even more valuable to the company. Also, we want to keep in mind personal responsibility. People tend to think of this in a negative light where, you know, we absolutely have to own up for all of our mistakes. But also remember, we have to own up for our successes because you are going to be your greatest cheerleader. You have to be your greatest cheerleader to be successful. So if you've had a big success, let it be known. So own your mistakes, but also own your successes. All right. So display devices, definition and types. The monitor or display is the primary output device for most computing devices. Thank you, Wozniak. It shows what is going on with programs and operating systems. The video card or display adapter handles all the communication between the CPU itself and the monitor. And the different types of display devices we're going to be talking about during this presentation are our CRTs, LCD, LED, plasma, OLED, and projector. Each of them kind of have their own unique characteristics, their own strengths, and their own weaknesses. All right, first, may look kind of like an 8-track tape to some of us. Julian, this is what monitors looked like before. You know, they were flat screens that we could put on the wall. These are the old school CRT monitors. They weigh about 300 pounds a piece. The picture is terrible. They use a cathode ray to display that the picture on the screen themselves. They are very bulky. They're kind of going by the wayside, but you still do see them out there today. Very important, much like a power supply, you never open a CRT TV to work on it unless you are a certified electrician. Because much like the power supply, I am not all here today. The little batteries, what are they called? Capacitors. The capacitors in the CRT. Can actually kill you if they're not discharged. And much like a computer, even though it is unplugged, there is still a residual charge in there. And there have been many people who will open up a CRT monitor to try to get some of the copper or any of that stuff out of there. They'll short out the capacitor and it's enough charge to actually kill them. Also, there are toxic chemicals inside the monitors themselves, one of the most prominent being mercury. So we don't want to break these things and open them up. We want to take them to a recycle unit as long as they're intact. If they're not intact, we can't. So we actually have to use hazmat disposal. So they are a big pain all the way around. But again, they are still out there. You still see them in some offices. You will still see them in some warehouses and stuff like that, because even though they are big and bulky, they're also pretty robust and can take a pretty good beating where a flat screen may not be able to. All right. All right, LCD, or liquid crystal display. Monitors composed of a large number of tiny little crystals called subpixels, and they're arranged in rows and columns, which is where we get our, you know, is it truly HD? Is it 4K? A lot of that comes down to the number of pixels that are in the actual screen itself. Each group of three pixels, which are red, green, and blue, each group of three subpixels forms a physical pixel. So you have red, green, and blue. Some have added actually yellow to allow for a much richer color palette. Current LCD monitors use a thin film transistor, or TFT, to control each color dot, providing fast picture display, crisp definition, and tight color control. So that would be a TFT. Now, there are two types of liquid crystal displays that you will come across. You have the in-plane switching, which has much truer color. It has better resolution, and the angles allow you to kind of see it from a broader angle. If you remember like the early days of flat panel screens, if you got off angle just about, you know, 10 degrees or something like that, part of the screen would be blacked out because you weren't actually seeing the pixels. That is an in-plane switching. In-plane switching corrects that problem. So you have a much wider viewing angle. You don't have to be sitting directly in front of it. The contrast to that is twisted pneumatic, which if you do get offside, it'll black out part of the screen because you have to be centered in front of it to get the full picture. Now, twisted pneumatic has hands down the fastest response time. So gamers, big key test question there. Gamers always tend to go for twisted pneumatic monitors because of the rapid response time or refresh rate. So there was a story in one of my networking books where a guy was talking about they were having a Madden competition at a local bar. They had about 30 screens set up. They just grabbed screens from wherever they could to get it all set up. And had gaming consoles at each TV, and there was like a $10,000 prize. About 20 minutes into the competition, they realized that there were stations where nobody was playing, and then there were lines at other stations, and they couldn't figure out why it was. And what it turned out to be was the ones where everybody was waiting for the lines, the gamers figured it out that those were the twisted pneumatics, so they would have the best advantage for reaction. Whereas the other ones with the in-plane switching didn't have as good a reaction. There's more blur, so it actually slows your reaction time down. So again, gamers go for the twisted pneumatic. In-plane switching has truer colors, so it looks prettier, but slower response time and wider angles. Questions so far? Yes, Cynthia.
For the in-plane switching, would that be a good monitor for like graphic artists or people that do visual work?
I would say probably because of the truer colors. So that would make more sense. And, you know, and it's not about the rapid response time. So maybe graphic artists would probably be a really good example of, you know, wanting an in-plane switching versus a twisted pneumatic because of the better color palette.
Do you know how many monitors are like that out in the market? Just offhand, like.
I don't know. I mean, I don't know how many. There's literally thousands.
There's such a thing, right? No, that's what I'm saying. That's why, because it's weird. This is like so brand new to me. Like, I really don't know. That's why I'm asking.
No, understood. Yeah. But a lot of times they will advertise it. So like down, you know, like the funny thing is as you go along this course, people will come in and say like, you know what? I went to Best Buy and I actually understood all that stuff on the side of the box, what they were trying to get it, you know, to get across to me. There was a young lady who will probably come in later. Ayana, who was in one of my first cohorts, and she finds out about halfway through that there actually is a difference in the HDMI cables. It's not just them trying to cheat you and, you know, make you pay more for a fancy cable. Like, there actually is a difference in its transmission speeds and all that stuff. And she was able to read it. And then she was talking about like arguing with her husband because he always went for the cheapest cable, never bought anything above that. And then they couldn't figure out why their 4K TV wasn't producing 4K images. So it is kind of funny that, you know, that will be a thing that as kind of clicks in your mind as we go through this. But typically on the box of the TV, it will tell you if it's an IPS or a twisted pneumatic, something like that. And typically the twisted pneumatics would be something that would be advertised as a monitor for gamers or something like that, because that's going to be like their primary market.
Thank you.
Not a problem. All right. Next. Do we really have to know the innards of a monitor? Yes, yes, we do. So LCDs don't produce their own light. So the crystals may change color, but they are dark. So the only way that we can actually see the images that are put on the LCD screen is with the aid of a backlight. The original backlights that were in the LCD panels were CCFLs, or cold cathode fluorescent lamps. These are much like the lamps, like the long skinny tube lamps that you would have in offices. You know, they kind of buzz and flicker and give you headaches and all that kind of fun stuff. Well, these are the light bulbs they had originally as the backlights behind the LCD panel, so that you could see things light up, which is partly why when you have blacks that are on the screen, like, you know, darker colors, they always look more grayish and stuff like that, because it's getting that flooding from the backlight rather than each individual pixel. So you have to use these CCFL lamps behind the LCD panel. Now, here's the part of the problem. So the power supplies, what do the power supplies do with power? So it comes out of the wall at AC, right? And then what does the power supply do? Power supply converts it to DC, right? Because the components inside the computers need direct current. Well, here's the problem. CCFLs require alternating current. So all the other pieces inside the monitor need direct current. The CCFLs need alternating current. So now we have to add another piece to the monitor, which is called an inverter. So this inverter takes direct current and then changes it back to AC so that we can light up the CCFL. That is unique to this type of monitor. So when we talk about troubleshooting monitors, when an inverter goes bad, it's very distinctive. It starts giving off a hissing sound. So we will talk about this a little bit later. So if you start getting a hissing sound out of a monitor, that should be a key indicator the inverter's bad. So, but again, we will talk about that a little bit more. So you have that panel up front, you have a backlight that sits behind it, flooding light behind the pixels, which allows us to see the images that are on the screen. Then things got a little more expensive. We moved up to LED, or light emitting diode. And we use this for a backlight rather than the CCFL. The nice thing is it consumes less power. It does not require us to have an inverter. And we can put it up in a grid formation where we can light up, I think originally it was quadrants. So it'd be like four quadrants that would, you could go light or dark depending on what was on the screen. So to a degree, it allowed for more contrast, brighter brights, darker darks. Now they actually have the individual diodes light up themselves, which makes it even more capable of having sharp contrast between the brights and the darks. So the other thing is LEDs, always keep in mind, LEDs don't flicker. They're either on or off. They don't flicker. So if you see flickering behind the monitor, it's a CCFL and the bulb's going bad. So it's another troubleshooting thing. So if you see flickering on the monitor and, you know, and it's a back, you know, it's the backlight that's flickering essentially, it's a CCFL, likely the bulb's going bad itself. All right. So LEDs, nice thing about that, unlike CCFLs, they use less mercury and therefore it is much kinder to the environment as well as lower power consumption to keep the lights on. Also, that's lighter, it's not as heavy. So a lot of improvements when we moved into the LEDs over the original LCDs. So keep that in the back of your mind. LCD is the liquid crystal display with a CCFL. If they say LED, that means it is a liquid crystal display with LED lights behind it. That's the distinction. That's what they will use on the test to distinguish between these two. All right.
Can you say that again?
Yes, I can. So let me go back two pages here. So LCD monitors, when they say that, it is a liquid crystal display with a CCFL backlight. So if you see this term used, that is what they mean. When they use the term LED, that is specifically referring to the backlight that is being used. So it's still an LCD display, still liquid crystal display, but instead of using CCFL, they're using an LED backlight. Is that good? Cool. All right. Pluses and minuses. LCDs, thicker and heavier. LEDs, thinner and lighter. LCDs, cheaper. LEDs, more expensive. The brightness is lower on the CCFL, much higher on LED. The lifespan on a fluorescent is shorter unless you are knowledgeable enough to change out the light in the back of that sucker or the inverter. LEDs last much longer. Like LED light bulbs are supposed to last something like 20 years or some crazy length of time. Although there is still that one Edison bulb that's been lit for over 100 years. Let's see here. Power, higher power consumption with the CCFL. Lower power consumption with the LEDs. So overall, LED, much friendlier to the environment. Fluorescent CCFLs, not so much. All right, we will, DW, we will get to that one probably towards the end of class and see what we can do on that one. All right. Next. Plasma monitors. So plasma, they use small cells containing ionized gas, similar to what is used in fluorescent lamps. The bonus of it, very high quality picture, really wide viewing angles, and less motion blur. Downfall, they were highly, highly susceptible to screen burn-in. If anybody's ever watched, you know, ESPN for an entire day, and they have that little icon down in the bottom, and then you change the channel, and the icon's still there. That's burn-in. You know, it happens quite a lot. I mean, I have, you know, for a while there, my wife was hooked on some show that was like an older 80s show, and it had the slower aspect ratio, so it was more square rather than rectangular. She watched that for about 3 weeks solid, and then every show we turned on after that had bars on either side of the TV because it had burned that in to the actual image. Sometimes it goes away, sometimes it does not. Depends on how severe the burn-in is. I think now most of the major networks, the little icon down at the bottom actually moves. So it moves around a little bit, so it prevents that burn-in. So that was something that they had kind of done to adapt to that particular problem. Because I imagine a lot of people were complaining, like, I like watching that a lot, but if I watch it more than a couple hours a day, my monitor just says it all the time. All right. Use cases. Mainly been used for TV displays, but now can be, purchased for display monitors that accept a output from a variety of different devices, including PCs, and they're no longer being made. Why? Because we have found a better technology. That technology is OLEDs. They're going extinct, Glean, but they're still out there. There's some people who refuse to give them up, My original Nintendo looks really good on a CRT monitor. It was just meant for 8-bit. So, OLEDs, the way of the future. It uses a layer of organic compounds with emissive electroluminescent qualities to emit light in response to an electric current. So we shock some of the particles, they light up. And the organic layer resides between two electrodes itself. The nice thing about this stuff is there's no black light at all. The LEDs themselves will light up, the LCDs, the little pixels in there actually light up themselves, which is so nice. It makes for such rich pictures. It makes for extremely thin monitors. And we can now start to curve these monitors and in some cases even fold them. So it is creating a whole new type of technology. And we are going to be able to use monitors in ways we never thought possible. Yes, Stephen.
Yeah, I wanted to ask, why are those screens able to fold like that?
Because they're not restricted by the backlight so much.
Oh, okay.
So it's just that thin film. And as long as they can find a way to kind of protect the film, then they're okay. So they can get a nice curvature out of it, which is really awesome for gaming, like this 3-monitor setup right here. There is like the new folding phones. Even with those folding phones, they have extra protection around that folding of the monitor itself. So it's just the more we utilize it, the more we can figure out how to protect the screen so it's not cracking or just damaging the actual monitor itself, then we can do much more things. I've seen like people create almost like bracers that will go on your arm that has like almost a TV screen on your arm. I mean, there's just lots of really cool stuff they're doing with it as the technology is becoming more and more adopted. Major downfall of this technology, it is super expensive right now. Lifespan on OLEDs, it's kind of like your mileage may vary. Depends on how much you use it, type of use. Typically, they will judge a monitor's lifespan in use hours. So, somebody may say like, I got 3 years out of that TV. I got 10 years out of the TV, but they're actually speaking about use hours when it's actually on and being used. Much like bulbs and a projector, they expect about 5,000 hours out of a bulb and a projector before it is expected to fail, give or take, a couple hundred hours. Similar on TVs. If the TV's on all the time, it may not last very long. It's just depending on the use hours. And again, the cost will kind of tell you that as well. So like some of the significantly more expensive ones are going to last longer, hopefully. And the cheaper ones, may get you about a year or two out of them. But some things surprise you. We ended up buying a generic HD TV, about 15 years ago, and that sucker still works perfectly and it's used all the time. And so it just depends. Do your research and you'll get better information on it. You know, look at the reviews, look at tech people that you trust, do, you know, putting them through punishment tests to see what, you know, they're capable of. And you'll have a pretty good idea as to where you want to go. Does the organic compound keep it cooler? I don't know if the organic compound itself keeps it cooler or the fact that you don't have an entire grid of lights behind it all wired would keep it cooler. So, I mean, yes, OLEDs run cooler than LEDs, but there's also a lot less electronics inside that system working. LG has a one that rolls into a stand. That is pretty cool. All right, projectors. So these are basically used to display computer or television images for an audience in two possible ways. So you have front view and rear view. Front view is hands down the most common. That's typically where you have the projector in the middle of the room, projecting it onto the screen in front of it. Rear view actually has the projector behind the monitor and it inverts everything and projects it. So you're actually in front of the screen and then behind the screen is the projector pushing the image onto it. And so because it's a rear view, it inverts the entire image so that it looks correct when you're viewing it from the other side of the screen. So, as I love the occasional history lesson, brightness of a projector is measured in lumens. I'm sure you've seen, like buying a flashlight, it'll say it's 800 lumens, you know, or something along those lines. Can anybody tell me what a single lumen is? We measure it in lumens, but what is a lumen? So what is a single lumen? You got to think really old. No guesses?
Lens?
Well, it's got to give off light. So what is a single lumen? Yeah, Steve.
It's like the brightness.
It is. It is the brightness. But I mean, they say they measure brightness by it, but what is their metric for what a single lumen is? Like cars, we measure in horsepower. That's pretty obvious. It's the power of a single horse versus, you know, the engine, what it can pull. Yes, Candido.
Candle?
Yes. Nice. Hunter also got it in chat. The light gives off by a single candle.
Good job, Hunter. Good job.
Did you Google it, Hunter, or did you just know it?
No, that was you said old, and I was like, I don't know, lantern candle, something.
Yeah.
Oil, yeah.
So a lumen, a single lumen is the light given off by a single candle. So if you buy a flashlight that says 800 lumens, it's the light of 800 candles.
Kelly, now I may be really dating myself, but in film school, is that the same thing as a foot candle?
I don't know, actually. I'd be interested in knowing that. I may have to look that up.
Because as we learned that a foot candle was the distance it took for one light, for one candle, which was approximately 1 foot.
Okay, so foot candle. So that would be like the brightness that, mm-hmm. you know, how far the brightness would extend. So that makes sense. That's probably where that does come from.
I wasn't born when Edison was alive, but I did go to film school, so.
So foot candles, I'll have to remember that one too. All right, so brightness in the projector is measured in lumens. The more lumens you have, the brighter it is. And it is determined by the amount of light given off by a source from a specific angle. Now, a projector's throw is the size of an image at a certain distance from the screen. So they have a recommended minimum and maximum throw. So like if you get too close, the image kind of like blends together, doesn't work so good. So like you can't have a, you know, an 8-foot image when you're only 3 feet from the wall. So there is an actual recommended throw where you get your best picture. If you go too far, the light is too far dispersed and it makes no sense. So other questions here. So throw is the size of the image at a particular distance. Hunter, did you have a question?
No, I found the answer to Lorraine's question. I put it in chat.
The imperial version of a lux, yeah, which we actually get into lux here. Lux is the perceived brightness of the image off of the screen. So we will be getting to that, I believe, on the next slide. So foot candles is perceived by lux. Okay, I like it. Another fun fact for the brain box. Did you have another question, Candido? All right.
No, just stop.
Okay. Just stop.
Yeah. Could you move back to two slides or three slides about the CCFL?
Right there?
Yeah.
You need to get a shot of it? All right, let me know when you're good.
Thank you.
Not a problem. All right. So inside the projector, the light that is produced by a lamp. They generate quite a bit of heat. If you've ever touched a projector that's been on for any length of time, it will burn you. So all projectors come with fans to keep the lamp from overheating. If the lamp overheats, it will blow out the bulb. And those bulbs are not cheap. Sometimes they can almost rival the cost of the projector. So like over half or three quarters of the cost of a projector could be just the bulb. All right. Monitor settings. Obviously, the brightness is determined by the monitor's backlights and it is measured in nits. Displays vary from roughly around 100 nits to over 1,000 nits on the high end. These next three are very important to understand the difference between. Brightness is a pretty easy one to remember. Now, response rate is the amount of time it takes for all the subpixels on a panel to go from pure black to pure white and back again. And this is measured in milliseconds. So that is your response time. So from completely off to completely on to completely off. That's response. Not to be confused with refresh rate. Your refresh rate refers to how often a screen can change or update its whole screen completely. For most computing issues, 60 hertz is fine. This is not okay for gaming, streaming, watching TV, any of that stuff. 60 hertz, you'll get a lot of blur. But for, you know, average computer programs, office work, things like that, 60 hertz, perfectly fine. For TV, stuff like that, I think 90 is about your minimum. Gaming, about 120 is your minimum. All right, contrast ratio is the difference between the darkest and lightest spots that the monitor can display. Good contrast ratio is considered to be around 450:1. So you want those darker darks and brighter brights to have that sharp contrast for the clearest pictures. All right, resolutions. Resolution is determined by the number of horizontal and vertical pixels that are displayed. Most monitors allow for two or more resolutions that you can pick one to use in the desktop settings of operating system. And just a hint, the optimal resolution for any monitor is called the native resolution. So that is the most efficient resolution that that screen can run on. The best picture it will possibly give you, that is considered its native resolution. So, and this is kind of the evolution of monitors or display devices here. You have your old VGAs, which were about 320 by 200, roughly about 256 colors, and used analog technology, much like the VGA cables, the DB15s. Then you had your Super VGA, which about doubled that, and then your extended graphics array, GA, which increased it even better. And then we get up to the HDs, the ultra extended HDTV. Finally, we get into that full HD, which is that 1080p. And you'll see it is that 1920 by 1080. That right there is where you get the 1080 from. So 1920 is your horizontal, 1080 is your vertical. And then you get the widescreen ultra extended, and it just keeps getting more and more. And I think we're up to 8K at this point. So each iteration, you get crisper images and lower power consumption. And hopefully over time, the cost comes down where it's more reasonable. Although we will eventually get to a point where our eyes can't actually distinguish between the sharpness of the images. So they would actually be able to produce images far sharper than our eyes can actually determine. And I think that's what's actually happening between 4K and 8K. I think that's the event horizon for that. What's the resolution for 8K? I don't know off the top of my head, so I'm gonna consult my coworker here. Says 7680 by 4320.
Yeah, those pictures are ridiculous. I mean, it's almost clearer than in reality. It's scary. Yeah.
And that's what I was saying is like it's now getting to a point where the clarity is becoming so that we can't actually distinguish it. It's like you see those, was it the HDR photos where it's like three photos, like super color kind of overlaid on each other. They'll take a picture of like, you know, the park near your house or something like, you're like, man, I've been to that park 1,000 times. It's never looked that good.
Yes.
All right. So, aspect ratio. So that is the ratio between the horizontal and vertical pixels. Most common is a 4:3 ratio. So 4 horizontal, 3 vertical, 16:9 or 16:10. And that is the ratios you'll see right here. It's the same thing. It's just a shorthand notation as to what the ratio is between your horizontal and vertical pixels. All right, native resolution. We talked about this one a little bit. Every monitor, every LCD monitor has a native resolution, and that is the sharpest picture it can possibly produce. Often your operating system, once you plug your monitor into it, it will talk to that monitor and will set to its native resolution. You can change it off of that, but the default setting in your operating system for the monitor that you place is its native. All right, questions so far? All right. Multiple displays. So most PCs nowadays, especially, DW, you got a question?
Yeah, I wasn't fast enough to put my hand up. When you get a monitor or you purchase a computer straight off the rack, does it come in its native display?
Well, when you hook it up to your computer, there is a two-way communication. So the way we hook up, it creates a two-way communication, and the default setting for that monitor is going to be its native resolution.
Okay.
That's what it should be. It's not to say that 100% of the time that is the case. 99.9% of the time that is. You can adjust off of that if you need to, but you can only typically adjust down. You can't make the image even better. You know, you can only typically adjust down. And once again, the native resolution is the point that will create the sharpest image for any monitor. So it's peak performing settings. That is its native resolution. So, multiple displays can present the same desktop on both displays. So, you know, you can use multiple monitors in different ways if you want. So you can have, you know, my desktop here and I have another monitor over here. I can have the exact same desktop displayed on both of those. That is called mirroring. So if, you know, you see somebody at a lecture, they have a laptop in front of them that they're looking at, and then they're using a projector as a secondary monitor, they can essentially set it up to be a mirror of each other. So they show the exact same stuff on both. The other way you can do it is to make it like it is another monitor, another area for you to put things where you can kind of move information over to it. That is called extending your desktop. You're creating additional real estate for you to be able to work on. Sometimes you can get these multiple monitors to work as a singular monitor instead of, because even if you extend it, it may say this monitor is one monitor and this monitor is another. So it's either on one or the other. It can't be on both. They do have devices and settings where you can have the same image projected across multiple monitors, so they operate as a single unit. One of the TAs I was working with originally, I think his rig is now up to 6 monitors. He has 3 on the bottom and 3 on the top, and he has built a setup for it and has them all operating as a singular monitor. It's pretty cool to see. But he also is a big time gamer as well. Will there be a lab setting up multiple monitors? I do believe there is a lab. Mark, can you correct me if I'm wrong on that one? We're doing extended and mirror desktop.
I don't remember seeing one. That's one I don't remember. Yeah, there probably is one, but I don't remember it offhand.
Darwin, what do you mean? Can you do both? Okay. What do you mean? So like if you have like 4 monitors, you could have 2 of them be extended and then mirror that to 2 others. Is that what you're saying?
So like, let's say you're doing a lecture, right? But you need two monitors, one to run to look at what you're doing, or monitor like maybe the class, and then one to project what you want the class to see.
Yes. Yes, you can do that. That essentially is an extended desktop. So you have 2 separate monitors. And that's kind of what I do here is like, I have a secondary monitor that I use that I have most of my material that I'm teaching up there. That is my shared screen over here, which is often why you see me looking off in this direction. And then I have my main monitor, which is where I have all my other stuff going on. So yeah, you can do that if you so choose. Are you trying to, but I don't know if you're saying, can you do both of those at the same time?
No. Yeah. I'm asking it. So I get the extension, right? You can split multiple tasks across the monitor, right? Mm-hmm. But then the other one is mirroring, where whatever I'm doing on one monitor gets projected onto a separate monitor. So yes, that's what I'm asking. Can you extend and then mirror only part of that extension is what I'm asking, basically.
With basic settings that you have in your operating system, I would say no. But are there programs that would allow you to do that? Yes. So the basic settings that come in all your operating systems, likely not. But again, there are add-ons that would probably allow you to.
DW, are you talking about a split screen?
No, what he was talking about is, like basically extending it, but only mirroring part of it to say a third marker. So like I extend to two, but maybe only mirror half of one to show to the class. So yeah, like with like some production software and stuff like that, that is absolutely possible. Because there are people that do that all the time. It's just on the native settings on your computer. No, not that I'm aware of. Yes, Steven.
What is that connector right there in front of all those monitors?
What is the name of that connector?
Yeah.
That's a really great question. I don't know off the top of my head. It is essentially, it's meant like to take a single image and stretch it across three. I'm sure we can look it up pretty quick.
It looks like it's either a hub with
like a
splitter in it.
Yeah, because like I mean, that. They use them in like stores all the time. Like they'll have, was it 9 screens? They'll have 3 up, 3 down, and then they plug all of them into a box like this where they all operate. You can either have them operate as a single screen or have the image splashed across multiple screens.
So it would be like a VGA connected to USB connector?
No, this is multiple VGAs. So like this is an older technology. But you could do it with HDMIs. They have boxes that would allow it to, you know, to do that. I mean, give me a minute during the break and I'll look it up and see what it is.
Cool.
See if I can find it. All right. Any other questions? All right, moving on. Monitor settings. This one comes up in security a lot because shoulder surfing is a risk. You have the privacy filter, which kind of works like the IPS, or excuse me, the twisted pneumatic, where if you get off center, everything on the screen goes black. So you have a privacy filter that you can put over your monitor, does kind of the same thing. So you literally have to be direct center in front of it in order to be able to read or see what is on the monitor. If you step off center, everything goes black. You're not able to read it. They have them for phones. They have them for computers, TVs, what have you. Not to be confused with an anti-glare filter, which is something a little bit different, which will fit over the front of the display screen and reduce the glare of external light sources like overhead. My old office, about 9 o'clock in the morning, I had a window that was back off to an angle behind me. Across the office, and it would put the sun literally right in the middle of my monitor, and it was about an hour before I could see again. So I had to actually invest in the anti-glare filter just to be able to work for that time. So additional things you can use to set your monitors up as well. All right, fun little quiz. Only 3 questions. So here is a breakdown. No, you do not need to memorize this. You need to hit the high points, just kind of understanding what exactly entails HD. That's 1920 by 1080. The aspect ratio is 16:9. And then maybe no VGA original, like old, you know, square TVs were typically 4:3. I'm with you, Mark. Yeah, they should have gotten off that bandwagon about 4 movies ago. All right, so ports and connectors. I knew we would come back to this. I knew you guys were like, you know what? I didn't get enough of this yesterday. Can we please do more? Well, we got it for you. There are more with regards to display devices that we have to get into, and we'll get into a few more when we get into networking, just to kind of round things out. We didn't want to give you all of that great exciting stuff in just one package. We kind of wanted to spread the wealth a little bit. So we're going to be talking about our VGAs, DVIs, HDMIs, which we should be pretty well familiar with, DisplayPort, Thunderbolt, not to be confused with a lightning cable, Composite video versus component. This is the one that tends to trip people up. Composite versus component. People always flip those two. S video, coaxial, which pretty much everybody's familiar with, and adapters and converters. So we're going to move through this pretty quickly. Old school 15 pin DB15, as we talked about it yesterday, also known as a VGA, typically always blue. It has that little rhombus shape where it looks like a D. If you put it up on its side, you can kind of see that angle here, and gets its fun name from the, you know, 15 pins inside it. So DB15, aka VGA cable. These pins are analog transmissions, and they typically send the signals in three colors. You have red, green, and blue, RGB, red, green, blue. All right. Next, DVI, or digital visual interface. This was a bridging technology going from analog into digital. So this was the technology that kind of bridged that gap, makes it kind of easy. So you have the A stands for analog. So DVI-A, that is your analog signal. You have your DVI-D, which is absolutely digital. Then you have the DVI-I, which actually did both. Now, here's the thing. This is where people get tripped up, and there are questions that come up like this. So you have the digital, analog, and then I think it's called interchange, which does both. This does not mean it is an adapter. What an adapter will do is change one to another. This means you can use it on either. So you can have a digital send and a digital receive, or you can have an analog send and an analog receive. You cannot send an analog signal to a digital receptor and have it work. It does not convert the signal. It just allows you to use this cable for either. And that is the DVI-I. So digital, digital only, analog, analog only. DVI-I could either be digital or analog. So not a converter, not an adapter. Questions? Yes, clean.
Okay, so looking at this, the monitors will either give you digital only, or is it, it'll still give you a picture, right? It'll still give you audio and visual video and video, or is it just?
I believe DVI only does video. It does not do audio.
Okay. So then when you have the dual link, is it giving you both?
Dual link allows communication to go both ways, but it does not transmit audio.
Okay, gotcha. So
typically in a scenario like this, you have the speakers in the back of the computer or the speakers internally in the computer, and that's where the sound is coming from, not from the monitor. So VGA cables, VGA and DVI, I believe, do not transmit audio at all. It's just strictly video.
So this is more towards the security sense, I think.
Am I right? More towards security?
Yeah, because, you know, like, say, for CCTVs,
mm-hmm.
or, you know, or, like, the cameras that you use in the department stores or in the street subways and stuff like that.
Well, typically, those would use coaxial.
Oh, okay, gotcha.
Okay. So, to my knowledge, I believe those predominantly use coaxial.
All right.
So these are typically used in monitors in offices especially when you started doing dual monitors and stuff, these came in and you'd have a VGA on one and a DVI on the other to allow you to have a dual monitor setup. But again, like I said, this was a bridging technology going away from analog, moving into digital. Then we got to the all common HDMI, which was able to transmit both digital video and audio at the same time. Designed predominantly to be used by home theater equipment and allows for several types of HDMI connectors. Right here, you have your standard HDMI, and next to it, you have the mini HDMI, and they both have the same number of pins. Now, it is being used pretty heavily on computers, TVs, theater systems, all that kind of fun stuff. And the most common, which is the original right here, a 19-pin connector. And then you have a small 19-pin connector right next to it. Maximum length of an HDMI cable depends very heavily on the quality of that cable. Contrary to popular belief, not all cables are created equally. All right. Next, we have the display port. Was created to replace the DVI. It's not very clear on here, but it has like a flat side, goes like this, comes up, over like this, and then back over. So flat on one side, and then it has the angled piece on the other side. So it does not get confused with an HDMI. This was predominantly used with Dell initially, but started moving towards other computers as well. Uses data packet transmission, similar to those used in like PCI cards, USB, and Ethernet as well. It is smaller, the smaller mini display port is commonly used for laptops, which is this one here. And the maximum length for a display port cable is about 15 meters or 45 feet. All right, next, the Thunderbolt, not to be confused with lightning cable. The lightning cable is what you hook up an iPhone to. Thunderbolt is a display cable, and it is the combination of two technologies. It combines both the PCI Express and the DisplayPort into a single signal. Very, very robust technology. And it also provides power all in the same cable. Yes, this is a proprietary technology used by Apple. It can transmit both video and or data as needed, maximum length of around 3 meters. And can get up to about 20 gigabits per second, which is blazing fast. And it uses the same connector as a mini display port, but is distinguished by the little lightning bolt icon next to it. So Thunderbolt 3 uses a Type C USB, which is the oval-shaped USB that has a reversible connector and can get up to 40 gigabits per second. Predominantly used by Mac and Apple, MacBook Air, Pro, and Mac Pro itself. Interestingly, on a Mac, they kind of jumped on this technology a little bit earlier than other laptops. This right here is actually the charger on a MacBook, and it is magnetic. So it's not a, you know, port that you plug into it. It is a magnetic strip that attaches to it. So if you end up walking away, it doesn't damage anything. It just kind of comes off. All right. Next, we have our composite video, also called RGB, RGB port. Composite video mixes the red, green, and blue together in the same signal, which would be this yellow port right here. And then the red and the white are your left and right audio inputs. This fun little connector right here that looks almost like your PS2 connector on the back of a computer, that is actually your S video out. And then here is the TV antenna port mini jack, which you could also use as an adapter for a coax if you so choose. I believe these are called like 1/8. Is it 1/8 inch jacks? And if you look on the side of them, you know those little rings that you see on your headphone jacks? That actually would distinguish between power left and right. And if it has, I think it's a fourth ring. So it's like another name for it is like, is it CCT? So it's like collar tip.
Yeah, that's it.
So they'll have these rings. So one ring will be your left side audio. One ring will be your right side audio. One will be power. And if they add an extra one, then it can receive voice. So that would be your microphone and your headphones. And that's what those little rings are on that 1/8 inch jack, which is the common headphone jack. Yeah, let me go back to that Thunderbolt. There we go.
Past
there you
it.
Go. Thunderbolt right there. There you go, Candido. Yes, Steven.
Yeah, something I never understood. Why was there always a left and a right audio input?
Why is there a left and a right? So if you're in headphones, it makes you feel like you're there. So you can actually distinguish between something coming from this side of you to that side of you. It's gotten significantly more complicated now. Now they have 360 audio for like headphones. It's crazy. Like you can actually like hear things like walking up behind you and stuff. I mean, it's amazing what they can do with it. But back then it was like your left and right audio feeds. So if you wore headphones or if you had a surround sound system or something like that, it would make it much clearer where the sounds were, make it more immersive.
Yeah, I quit going to the movies. I had a surround sound setup at the house. I didn't go to the movies anymore. I had a movie theater in my basement.
I know, right?
Yeah.
And if you have like 4K in your house, that's actually better resolution than you could get at a movie theater. I mean, granted, I understand going to the movie theaters, like it's the whole experience and stuff like that. It's, you know, it's there, but for picture clarity, and if you have a, you know, pretty, you know, they, you can get a pretty good surround sound system for pretty inexpensive nowadays, get one of those set up and it's a way better experience. But I am still a fan of the movie theaters. So there, I do pick some rare ones that come out, like every now and then I'll pick one that comes out and be like, okay, that one's got to be seen in the theaters. Yes, Cynthia.
I kind of sort of wonder if like movies going to be ancient because the way technology is moving, I don't know, like it's weird. Like movie, like going to the movies with something like, oh, it's wonderful, but I feel like the future might be like home. Like it's going to be less movie theaters.
I don't know. I mean, I I'm with you to a degree in that because of the way the technology is evolving, and then also the way the movie companies were going, they're saying they'll release it on the streaming and in the theater at the same time. It's like, well, why am I going to go to the theater when I can just watch it at home? But there's still something to be said for that experience, you know, going to the movie theater, getting that flat soda and the stale popcorn and sitting down and just, you know, being in the middle of the theater and, you know, having the big screen and then the THX, you know, insignia comes on and blows your eardrums out before the movie even starts. I mean, there's a lot to be said for it. I mean, my kids really get a kick out of it when I took them to the theater. It's just the experience of seeing a TV that's two or three stories tall, and it's just so amazing. So to a degree, that can't be taken away.
You seen the theaters in Japan? I think it's Japan with the gigantic 3D projectors that they have.
Where I have not seen that.
You're walking, and it like a train will be traveling over your head.
Oh,
and
wow.
And it's 3D, and it's crazy. It is so realistic.
I'm going to have to look that up. So I have not seen that. Mm-hmm. I have not seen that. I'm going to check that out. Yes, Lorraine.
Again, you know, going back to being a film student, even with all of our technology, film movies are still shot on 70 millimeter film.
Mm-hmm.
And that's the dividing, I believe that's the dividing aspect that will, I don't know how that's ever going to be replaced, because although it's transferred to video and becomes digital, mostly for editing and for duplication and distribution, the original film is shot with a texture. And the only way, I mean, it's comparable to why I think, in spite of the fidelity of CDs, we still love vinyl. And there is a dimension and a depth that all of our technology still has not been able to, I won't say surpass, but it's a question of taste and texture.
I mean, there is, you know, I would agree with you on that.
Because like, even like in the music industry, like things like, especially like I've worked with different people, and the analog is way better. It's warmer, there's more saturation. Now like when people make music, it's all digital, just sound waves. So it's a different type of frequency, but everything has moved to digital when it comes to music. You barely ever see vinyl, like people coming out with like, hey, some producer came out and he has a vinyl record. I don't hear that. And then so like with film, I'm looking at it from the perspective, yeah, like Lorraine is absolutely right. Like it's, to me, it's the integrity. But again, you know, technologists and scientists will find a way, or, you know, producers will find a way to move from that specific medium into something different, and it's going to change the quality of movie making.
I hope
you know, you can only hope that it gets good and doesn't lose in its integrity.
Well, I mean, honestly, I think we need to get back to just good storytelling, because I think that has been lost over the last, gosh, like 20 years. I mean, I want to see good stories again, not just a regurgitation of something that was, you know, told. So that's part of where I started getting disenchanted with it a little bit. All right. Yes, Lorraine, real quick.
A quick story and a true story. I actually was in a class at USC when George Lucas gave us a demonstration of his rough cut of Star Wars, because he had graduated about 5 years before. And his dissertation film was called THX 1138.
Yep.
Which we also saw. So the day he came to the class to ask our opinions, I sat in the back because I really didn't want to get picked on, because I didn't think he would appreciate what I had to say. And it's exactly what you just said about storytelling. THX 1138, although it was a student film and it didn't have multi-million dollars budget, the characterizations in it was so much more, the storytelling was so much richer. It was so much more interesting. Mm-hmm. And, you know, there was not a lot of he didn't have the special effects that he later would have. And of course, as we were 40 students, and he noticed that I didn't say anything. So he called on me. And I had to say, you know, in all due respect, I liked it because, and he said, well, you know, it's a point well taken. And he asked me which character I really liked in THX 1138. And it was Chewbacca and Harrison Ford's character.
Mm-hmm.
He said, I'm going to remember that. So I don't know if I could take credit for it, but Chewbacca and
oh, just own it. Yeah.
You know, so
you know those that was me. Those two right there. All me.
I got a credit in the movie for it.
That's pretty cool though. It's awesome. I like that story. All right. Yes, real quick, Cynthia. Did you not mean to put your hand up?
No, sorry, that's a mistake. No problem. I didn't put it down.
All right, gotcha. No problem. All right. So this is component, not to be confused with composite. So composite is the yellow, red, white. That's composite. Component, yet another bridging technology, which is the green, yellow, blue, and then the white, red, yeah, green, red, blue. Eventually I'll get my colors. And then the white and red for your left and right audio. This also goes by another name, if you see it, so it does not confuse you. It is Y. What is it? C, B, C, R. So Y, C, uppercase, lowercase, B, C, R. I'm sure there is a reason why they labeled it this way. I never went deep enough to, you know, to figure it out, but this is another way of saying component video, where you have the red, green, blue for video, and then the red and white for audio. So definitely burn it into your brain, the difference between component and composite, because that will come up. All right, next we have S video, very short-lived technology. It has a 4-pin or 7-pin round. Like I said, it looks similar to the PS2 on the back of your computer for the keyboard or mouse connector. It looks very, very similar to that. Used by some televisions and video equipment, though not many. Older camcorders and cameras had a 6-pin version of it or a mini DIN connector as well. So that is S video. Again, very short use period that it was predominant and limited use too, because people wanted to stick with the composite. And then when they were starting to move to HD, that's where component kicked in, because that could give you that 720p, and that was pushing towards actual HD television. And then eventually we went to the HDMI, and then nobody wanted to mess around with the five little plugs for the component video. They just like, you know, it's just easy, one little plug, I'm done, it's my audio, my video, and I don't have to worry about it anymore. Finally, we go to coaxial. Now, coaxial has two different types of connectors. Yes, we need to know them. First, we have what is called the BNC connector, which stands for Bayonet Neil Councilman. These were the people who actually came up with it. It has like these little prongs that stick out on the female side, which go in, and there's actually slots in this side where it goes in, and then kind of twists together to lock. It's a real quick disconnect, quick connect. And that is a BNC connector. The other type of connector you have is the F-type connector. which is the one you typically saw in your household. This one here, which was like a threaded screw that you would screw onto the television. This was something that, you know, when they would use this, it was typically understood that it was going to be in that place or that position for a very long period of time, almost never moved. So they would put this on it. It secured it pretty well and didn't have to move. This type here was typically used in network settings, actually. When you first started seeing networks, especially on bus networks and things like that, they used the B and C connectors because they could quickly be disconnected and connected with very little trouble. So the B and C and the F type to be utilized with coaxial cables. Glean, if I ever get out of line on this, please feel free to step in and correct me.
Which questions are? No, well, there's nothing to correct, really, other than that it was, it's also, you know, like you have your audio, your video, and your internet source that can come out all from one cable.
Yes.
Because Verizon does that for your homes and with your routers. And I know for me as a dish technician, we use this for your satellite dishes.
Mm-hmm.
All righty. So I guess my question is that are we to know the, say, the megahertz that it's supposed that they're in line to carry, because each cables have different brands and they carry, but so many different cable settings and such other, meaning like one is good for one system, one is not good for another.
Good question. Answer is no, you don't need to know that.
Okay, thank you.
They're predominantly, they want to know the different types, the generic types of coaxial cable you have.
Right.
And then the different types of connectors that are associated with it. So the B and C and the F types.
All right.
They get a little bit more into the megahertz and stuff like that when you get into Network Plus. It becomes a little bit more relevant. For the purposes of this, they kind of want you to be familiar with the technology.
All right. Works for me.
Mm-hmm. All right. Now we talk about adapters and converters. So here's a bunch of different types here. You got your DVIs. And on the back, it would likely be either a VGA. On the back of this one, you have an HDMI to DVI. And then on this one, so that means it would need to be a DVI-D or a DVI-I. I think this one with the pins missing is a DVI-D. And then you have the VGA to DVI as well. And then down here, you've got display port to DVI. And then I believe this is HDMI to DisplayPort as well.
Okay, yeah, DisplayPort.
Yep. And converters help convert things from one signal to another so that they can be used. All right, video cards, also called adapter cards. We did talk about these a little bit, showed some pictures about it. Most motherboards today have some mother ports already attached to them. There is video capabilities already integrated in. The video cards that you can add later improve the video output, also give you a better variety of options of connectors. So if you want to go to, say, fiber optic sound, or if you want to go with Thunderbolt or something like that versus going with just a DVI or VGA, you can use your PCI cards to upgrade those things and allow for those connections as well. They also can allow for the use of more than one monitor without the adapter tool that we showed earlier. And the video cards themselves will either connect to an AGP or a PCI Express slot on the motherboard themselves. Typically, the most common slot you're going to use is the PCI 16 with regards to video. The main manufacturers for these cards are NVIDIA and ATI Radeon. Obviously, there are others in the market, especially now. Some others have risen to prominence. At the time of this, these were the ones who were the predominant ones. Again, we looked at this when we were looking at the inside of a computer. As you can see, it almost looks like a motherboard. If we're getting more and more familiar with the motherboard, we got our GPU under here. Here's our cooling unit sitting on top of it. We got our heat sink over here. And then this is your connector that will sit down into your PCI slot. Here are your external connectors for your video output. Pretty straightforward. Obviously, this is an older card. More modern ones are going to be using HDMI, DisplayPort, Thunderbolts, things of that nature as well. All right, continuing on. Ooh, as we go to the sticks. All right. Robert, can you please tell us what number one is? All right. LaQuisha, can you please tell us what number one is? Right here. Can be hard to see. So,
hey, so I'm here.
Profile. Looks like this. So it's flat on one side, it's got a little bit of an angle on the other. See you mouthing it, you're right. You're on mute, so I can't hear you.
Oh, I'm sorry, I'm here. I thought it was the Thunderbolt, but the DisplayPort?
Yes, ma'am, it is a DisplayPort.
Okay, sorry about that.
No problem. And it has that nice little D insignia up on it here as well. Sometimes there are fun clues on the connectors themselves. So on the top, there's that little D or display port.
Okay, Mark, I also sent you a message.
All right, next. For number two. So number two, yeah, go ahead, Stephen.
Is the DVI dual?
Dual link, okay. Is it an I or is it a D? DVI. Is it an A? You say?
DVI A.
A?
Yeah, no, my bad, D.
D? DVI. Very good guess. DVI-D? I believe this is a DVI-I.
Oh, DVI-II?
Yeah, I believe it. DVI-I. But good guess. Solid on DVI. Number three. Jerusalem, can you help us? So number three, right here in the middle top. All right. No problem. So Fao, can you tell us what number three is at top center?
Not sure.
Give you a hint, it is proprietary to Apple. Chat blew up right away. It's a combination of two technologies.
Casio.
Check chat. Susan, you want to help out?
Is that the Thunderbolt?
That is the Thunderbolt. Do you remember the two technologies it combined?
Oh, I don't, but I'm going to guess. Is it the PCIe?
Yes.
And no, I can't remember the second one.
Take a guess.
Julian said the DisplayPort.
Okay, DisplayPort, yes. PCIe and DisplayPort combined to make the Thunderbolt. And typically the Apple cables tend to be white, although you can buy them different colors if you wish. That's just their standard color. All right, number four. Let's see here. Do what?
Never seen a black Thunderbolt.
You can buy them. So like, but it's one of those things, like the standard one that they will just give you. It's a white cable. So number four, Miyaza, can you please help us out with number four? Great job, Susan. Right here, number four, bottom center. Yes, absolutely, Miyaza. It is a VGA. Very good. Oh, got him switched up. Thank you, Julia. All right, also known as a DB15. Thank you, Stephen. Great job, Miyaza. Number five. Venkata, can you please tell me what number five is? It's over here on the upper right, right here.
Bonnet.
I'm sorry, what?
Bonnet.
Oh, you're saying, okay, so the connector, yes. Bayonet, Neil Councilman, the BNC connector, yes. Absolutely, that is the connector on there, the BNC. What type of cable is that attached to? You're getting it in chat a lot, but excellent job on the connector, because that was gonna be my very next question. So it is a coaxial for typically seen in TVs. Older networks utilize them and has the BNC connection. But good job, Inkata. And lastly, Matuno, can you please tell us what number six is right here?
Is it mini HDMI or is the regular HDMI?
I believe that is the regular HDMI. Mini is... a little bit smaller, but it is hard to tell in a picture like this. So I'm going to go ahead and take a guess that it is a regular HDMI. Okay. You don't typically see the minis very, very often. They are a little bit more specialized, but very good, everyone. All right. So troubleshooting common monitor issues. Talk a little bit about ghosting, streaking, fuzzy vertical edges, monitors not showing any red, bad pixels, pixels stuck, flickering images, dim images, and hissing noise. Who remembers what the hissing noise meant? Cynthia.
That the fluorescent light bulb is, if I'm not mistaken, gone out or it's bad.
Well, the hissing.
So
that distinctive hissing noise. You're on the right track. You've got the exact right technology.
the hold up. I know that it's the backlight is connected. If that goes bad, that's what creates the hissing.
Well, it has to do with the power. Has to do with the power. But great guess. I like it. You were exactly the right technology.
That's it.
The what?
The inverter is.
Yes, the inverter has gone bad. Great, Candido. So yes, once the inverter is going bad, you'll get a very distinct hissing sound out of the monitor. So we already know that one.
Okay.
So ghosting, streaking, or fuzzing, a lot of that comes down to the cables. So ghosting is like if you have somebody standing in the middle and then you have like a secondary image of that person a little bit off to the side, a lot of that comes down to the cables themselves being bad. So if you have like fuzzy vertical edges where there's like streaks going down through it, a lot of it comes down to just strictly the cable itself is bad. Maybe it's connected improperly, like you haven't fully seated the cable properly, things like that. So check your cables first, try a different cable. Likely that's going to correct your issue. Again, if you have a single color missing, because remember each subpixel on a flat screen has the red, green, and blue in the pixel itself. So if a color is missing across all of the pixels, again, you look for your cable. Look at your cables. Do they have bends or breaks in the cable to where, say, one of the transmitters is not working properly? That would account for you missing essentially a single color out of it. I don't know, call animal control hunter, I'm guessing. But all right, so bad pixels, LCD monitor. You have dead pixels, which means the pixel doesn't light up at all. It's just like a little black spot on your monitor. You have stuck pixel, which is pure, or excuse me, a lit pixel, which is pure white. And it's always white no matter what. Whenever the TV's on, that pixel is stuck on white. And then you have a stuck pixel, which is on a particular color. It never changes. It can be annoying. It does happen. But there are actually two ways you can deal with this problem. First one's on the screen. So what would you think would be, you know, since it's on the screen, somebody shout it out. What is the first way we can fix or deal with dead pixels, lit pixels, or stuck pixels?
Restart your computer?
Well, even if you restart it, those pixels are still going to be stuck. This is strictly in the display device.
Replace the monitor.
So replace the monitor. If it's under warranty, hopefully it is. You replace the monitor and, you know, they will take care of it, you know, if the pixels are stuck or not lit or not changing. So good guess on the reboot, though, because that does fix a lot of issues. So what do we think might be the second method for dealing with bad pixels? Check the cables. Good guess.
Refresh the screen.
Refresh the screen. Maybe work.
Change the refresh rate of the resolution.
I mean, another good guess. I won't necessarily do it. This is the cold-hearted IT version. The answer is deal with it. So if you have stuck pixels on there and it's really not affecting your work, well, we're not going to buy you a new monitor. You can still work with about, you know, 20 or 30 dead pixels up in the corner. So you're just going to have to deal with it. So those are your typical options for it. You can replace the monitor or deal with it. Some people may not want to shell out the extra money to, you know, get the new monitor, or it may not be under warranty anymore. And it's like, you know what? It's not really affecting me that much. I'll just put up with it for now. All right. Flickering image with an LCD points to either a very inexpensive panel with too much light bleed from the backlight, or a dying CCFL bulb. Always remember, LEDs don't flicker. So if the CCFL itself has gone bad, you can replace the bulb. The bulbs tend not to be overly expensive, but getting in and out of a monitor, it's no fun. but you can do it on the LCDs if you so choose. Swap out the bulbs and you should be good. Dim image, especially only on the top or bottom half of the screen, points to a dead or dying backlight as well. Because sometimes you'll have two, sometimes you'll have four backlights when you're dealing with the CCFLs. If one of those goes out, maybe the top of your screen is dim, but the bottom is fine. Still points to a bad CCFL that needs to be replaced. And then the distinct hissing noise that we talked about, letting you know the inverter is going bad. And usually when they finally go, there's a fun puff of blue smoke and a sound of popcorn. And then you know it's time for a new monitor. So, one more quick matching game. Let me go ahead and pause.